How to be a good person. Now, I don't know you, but I'm pretty sure you're not a bad person. I've never had the displeasure of meeting someone who I would describe as truly evil. And the reason you're not a bad person is partly because of the reason you clicked on this video, because you want to do good, at least some of the time. The question is, of course, how to do this. What even constitutes a good action? At the end of this video, you will not only know the answer to this question, but you will have a concrete and practical rule that tells you what the right thing to do is in any situation. To reach that point, we will need to start at the beginning. When talking about being a good person or doing the right thing, we are inadvertently talking about ethics. Now, when you just heard me say the word ethics, you might have rolled your eyes or let out a bored sigh. Perhaps you are of the opinion that ethics is just about having pointless semantic discussions about dilemmas that have no real answer anyway. I, however, wholeheartedly disagree. Before even beginning to think about answering the question how to do something, you first have to answer the question whether you should, whether you ought to. Ethics, therefore, is the backbone of any and all actions. Which means that if we get ethics wrong, the consequences could be grave. Imagine devoting years of your life to a certain project, only to realize after its completion that you probably shouldn't have done that. So, first of all, we need to agree that there is an answer to be found. In other words, we have to agree that morality is not purely relative or a matter of perspective. Different cultures have different moralities, and although we can understand why that is the case, that does not mean that they are all equally right. Most of us find killing other people to eat their flesh to be wrong, but cannibal tribes living in the jungles might disagree. Most of us are against genocide, but the culture of Nazi Germany would have disagreed. If you are a moral relativist, you wouldn't say that it was wrong of the people in Nazi Germany to condone or commit genocide, because you'd believe that the cultural norms dictate what is or isn't considered moral. Moral relativism says that there are no objective moral truths. Eating human flesh in a cannibalistic tribe, or owning slaves in 17th century Georgia, would have all been perfectly fine and moral at the time, because that is what the culture decided was moral. However, this seems very strange. Morality might be a social construct, but just because the concept may have been created by people does not mean that it's all just relative or arbitrary. Also, the fact that there is much discussion and disagreement about moral questions does not mean a moral truth does not exist. Some things are unquestionably right, and others are unquestionably wrong, and the difference is at least objective enough that the variation in culture can't just dispense with it. What is right or wrong is not simply relative or a matter of opinion or defined by tradition or what someone is used to. And so, as a first step, we ought to reject moral relativism and thus embrace moral absolutism. Now, believing that some things are right and others are wrong does not mean that we know what they are. That being said, people do try to decide for themselves what the difference is, though they might think about ethics in very different ways. We will now be discussing three ways people tend to think about ethics in their daily lives. First of all, there are people who barely think about ethics at all. When questions relating to these topics arise, they will often simply follow their gut feeling, what feels right or wrong intuitively. This is, of course, dependent on a lot of factors, such as upbringing, temperament, social position, wealth, health, and mood, which vary wildly not just from person to person, but also from day to day or moment to moment for the same person. This means that someone might decide to tell the truth in one situation, though if they encounter the exact same situation the next day, but whilst having a different mood, they might decide to tell a lie. It follows that we cannot find any objective morality here. Morality should not be decided simply by the mood someone is in. That is merely another form of moral relativism which we have just rejected. This brings us to our second premise. Primarily following your intuition leads to inconsistencies in your beliefs and actions, which ought to be avoided. Now, let us move on to the next category of people. These people have distinct moral principles on which they act. Let us examine this further by using an example. Imagine a boy named Alex. Let's say that Alex greatly values honesty and loyalty, as a lot of us do. They are, in fact, Alex's core principles. Now let's imagine that Alex has a friend at school called Jessica. After a particularly difficult exam, Jessica tells Alex in confidence, as her friend, that she has cheated on the test.
Now, the next day, after grading their tests, the teacher suspects Jessica of foul play and asks Alex outright whether Jessica has cheated on her exam. Now, Alex faces a moral dilemma. What should he say to his teacher? As said before, Alex values both honesty and loyalty. Alex believes he has to stay loyal to his friend who told him about her cheating in confidence. But on the other hand, Alex also believes that he should answer the teacher honestly. In this theoretical example, there is no answer. However, in real life, even when faced with difficult decisions, we still have to choose. Alex can't opt out of this dilemma. He can either choose to answer truthfully or he cannot. But what would Alex have chosen, being in that situation, on the spot, if his moral code of valuing honesty and loyalty does not give him the answer? Well, perhaps Jessica was actually not such a good friend anyway. In fact, maybe she even badmouthed him behind his back. Maybe, in this situation, Alex thinks it serves her right to be punished, so he might tell the teacher the truth. But perhaps his teacher has been giving him bad grades and lots of extra homework all year, and he is not at all inclined to help the teacher make her job easier. In that case, he might choose to lie. Of course, now Alex's moral code is no longer guiding his decision-making, but rather the context of the situation, his feelings for the people involved, his mood. In other words, his gut, his intuition. So, as you can see, although we at first believed we moved on from one category of people who don't really think about ethics at all to people who follow a moral code made up of principles, these two groups of people are actually one and the same. What is guiding them, when it comes down to it, is, above all, their intuition. What I've described in the second category is essentially a very simplified version of the ethical theories of principlism and virtue ethics. One of the main objections to virtue ethics, as we have seen, is that it offers us no guidance on what to do when two virtues or principles are in direct opposition of each other. This is because there is no hierarchy of importance between different virtues, and even if there were, why would that one virtue be more important than the other one? Are you not, once again, simply using your intuition to make those decisions? Another problem is that one has to wonder which virtues to choose to value. Loyalty and honesty? But why not, for example, say courage? People also use their gut feeling to choose even which principles to have, meaning that not their principles, but their intuition, still stands at the top of the hierarchy of their decision-making tree. It may even be the case that they, perhaps subconsciously, already intuitively chose a certain action and immediately afterwards rationalize it using a virtue they can conveniently and retroactively file their decision under, as if it were the virtue that ultimately led to their decision instead of their gut feeling. Now, I'm not saying that someone's gut feeling can never be right, but is it not arrogant to assume that your particular gut feeling, your intuition, the core of your being, is by nature good? Why would it be? Making this assumption, which many people seem to do, is actually quite dangerous. It leads to the misinterpretation of, for example, famous quotes such as, "The only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good man to do nothing," from Edmund Burke. Upon first reading this, most people, myself included, immediately and arrogantly presume that they are the good men meant by the quote, and see it as a call to action. But why would we be good men? Would Hitler not have looked at that quote and thought to himself, "I'd better increase the efficiency of those concentration camps if I want to prevent the evil of the Jews from triumphing in this world"? How presumptuous, how dangerous, to assume one's own goodness by nature. No. What we need is a strict moral guideline, a supreme rule, if you will, which tells us what the right thing to do is, regardless of our background, upbringing, or mood. This brings us to our third premise.
The only way to rise above primarily following your intuition is by always following a supreme norm.
Luckily, there are two ethical theories which indeed have what we are looking for, a supreme norm, a much thought-over rule standing at the top of the hierarchy of decision-making. The theories that hold these golden rules are called utilitarianism and deontology. Both utilitarianism and deontology follow a single simple rule, which is more important than any other value or rule or principle. However, both rules are vastly different from one another. Let us first discuss utilitarianism, which is derived from the word utility. The supreme norm of utilitarianism states that an action is morally right if and only if it maximizes the total happiness and minimizes the total suffering in the world. Now, surely we can all agree that happiness is good and suffering is bad, yes? And not only does the rule of utilitarianism recognize this, it also states that we should not simply choose an action that causes more happiness than suffering, but choose the action that causes the most net happiness or the least net suffering. With every single decision, utilitarianism considers the total net balance between happiness and suffering, and wishes to tip the scales toward happiness as much as it possibly can. This goes far beyond the happiness of a single individual, but is rather about the total happiness of everyone affected by the decision. I say everyone, but by that I mean, of course, all creatures who are capable of experiencing pleasure or pain. Beyond this, everyone is equal, whether they be lawyer or taxi driver, king or peasant, man or woman, human or dog, liberal or conservative, friend or foe. All are equal, except in how much happiness or suffering one would experience from the outcome of a certain action. Therefore, the happiness and suffering pertaining to the consequences of an action are the only value worth considering when making a moral decision, according to utilitarianism. Besides utilitarianism, there's also deontology, deon meaning duty. Deontology follows a supreme norm that is referred to as the categorical imperative, first thought of by Immanuel Kant. There are actually four ways in which the categorical imperative can be formulated, each with their own different nuances, though Kant believed that each formulation ultimately boils down to the same thing. Here we will be using the second formulation of the categorical imperative, which goes as follows. Never treat others as a mere means to an end, but always at the same time as ends in themselves. From this rule it can be derived that acts such as stealing, lying, manipulating and murder are all categorically wrong. They have to be because each of these actions implies that the rights and wishes and autonomy of another are not respected, even disregarded, meaning that they are being used as a mere means to achieve a certain end. For example, by lying to someone who you want to borrow money from, you are taking away their ability to themselves make an informed decision about how to use their money, and not taking into account their wishes or respecting their autonomy as an individual, simply to increase the odds of them giving you the cash. You would have reduced them to mere means to achieve the end of them giving you the money. The individuals that require moral consideration with this supreme rule are all sentient beings, meaning all living beings that are the experiencing subject of a life with an individual welfare and intrinsic worth, all to be respected, regardless of their usefulness to others. The great thing that both these theories share is that everyone gets the same treatment. A big problem with people following their intuition is that they naturally choose the ones they are close with over others, even if others are many, even if they have to violate the rights of others. This sentiment is understandable and maybe even admirable. We all intuitively would rather kill someone else's mother than our own, right? But it is clear that there is no logical argument that justifies someone giving people they like, or people from their inner circle, special treatment over ones they don't like, or who are not part of that inner circle. People form groups, and groups get into conflicts, and the people from each group are willing to cause a lot of suffering to prevent those from their group to suffer a little, or are willing to violate the rights of others for the sake of the rights of the people from their group to not be violated. This is not logical, neither utilitarian nor deontological, and certainly not a consistent way of thinking. It is the same as Alex choosing to lie for the simple reason that he is closer to Jessica than his teacher. And so the corruption of intuition is neatly avoided by both utilitarianism and deontology. So, these two theories both sound very nice, but what can be easily overlooked when presented like this is that utilitarianism and deontology do not play well together whatsoever. They are, in fact, in many ways, each other's antithesis. This leaves us with a problem. We wanted a single supreme norm standing at the top of our decision-making hierarchy so that our ethical decisions would always be consistent and never be biased. Now, instead of one, we got two. But when it comes to most ethical dilemmas, they disagree. Let me explain the duality between utilitarianism and deontology a bit further. Utilitarianism, being a consequentialist ethical theory, places all moral weight with the consequences of an action,
while deontology places all moral weight with the action itself and the intentions behind that action. A very succinct way of putting it is that utilitarianism and deontology fundamentally disagree on the issue of whether the ends justify the means. The issue is that the utilitarian would say that the ends always justify the means, where no means is too horrible, while the deontologist would argue that the ends never justify the means, no matter how great the ends. The following paradox is a very nice illustration of the problem utilitarianism and deontology are arguing over. The paradox goes as follows.
What do you do when there is an evil you cannot defeat by just means? Do you stain your hands with evil to destroy evil? Or do you remain steadfastly just and righteous, even if it means surrendering to evil?
This is a paradox, because in either case, evil remains. A utilitarian would rather commit evil to destroy a greater evil, meaning causing suffering to end a greater suffering. A deontologist would rather surrender to evil than to become it themselves, which to a deontologist would mean treating another as a mere means to an end of putting a stop to another person using someone else as a mere means to an end. Confusing, I know. The utilitarian's defense may be that less suffering is of course better, to which the deontologist might reply that there would be no longer a moral difference between you and the original evil if both are willing to commit the same crimes for their cause. We can more concretely see this opposition when answering the following question using both theories. Should you kill one person to save two? A utilitarian would say, of course, better that two should live than one. While a deontologist would answer, no, murder is wrong no matter what. Do the means of killing one person justify the ends of saving two? What about the ends of saving 1,000? The answers of the utilitarian and deontologist would stay the same. At this point, you might wonder if it would not be better to combine both theories instead of choosing one. After all, they both have a point, since there have to be times when the ends justify the means and when they don't, right? Would it not be better to adhere to both the utilitarian rule and the deontological rule as much as possible, and when they clash, decide ourselves which rule to follow? This sounds very reasonable, but we are overlooking something important. The means by which we would be deciding between the utilitarian or deontological stance in any given situation would, when it comes down to it, be nothing more than our intuition, our gut feeling. Meaning that, once again, our intuition stands at the top of our decision-making hierarchy and we have not progressed any further from where we started. The rules of utilitarianism and deontology are meant to be supreme. However difficult the choice between them, choose we must. But then, which would we choose? The attentive listener may rightly ask at this point that, since we do not have an ethical theory which we can follow yet, choosing an ethical theory now would be done using only our intuition, meaning that our intuition is still at the top of our decision-making hierarchy. This is a valid concern, and one I can't completely resolve. However, choosing an ethical theory using your intuition now would mean never having to rely on your intuition again when making any ethical decisions beyond this point, which is still preferable to your intuition taking the lead every time a moral dilemma arises. After all, in individual moral dilemmas, a lot of emotions and other contextual factors cloud your judgment, while in this moment, without a specific dilemma and with both of these two ethical theories laid bare, our choice will be least affected by outside factors that ought to be unimportant. So, choose we must, and we must choose before a moral dilemma arises, and subsequently always adhere to the rule we have chosen. Basically, we have to choose now. A tall order, I know. Now, at this point, I should probably tell you to stop watching this video and make up your own mind. So far, I have almost solely given logical arguments to get to this point. Most logical arguments that seek to either disprove utilitarianism or deontology, however, fall short. Most of them rely on taking the supreme rule in question to its extremes, and then pointing out how absurd its conclusion is. But to be honest, for the majority of regular issues you encounter in real life, the logical counter-arguments don't really apply, and sometimes seem a bit desperate. I really should tell you to just look inward and find your own answer, but I can't help using this opportunity to make a plea for the theory that I firmly believe to be right. And, full disclosure, the ethical theory I personally subscribe to is deontology. So, what follows is essentially an argument for deontology and against utilitarianism, which is largely rooted in my own personal biases. Do not take it as fact. I may have already given away my own opinion when talking about the quote from Edmund Burke,
the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing, and how people arrogantly interpret this as a call to action meant for them. Utilitarianism more often calls to action, saying that you should do something to create the greatest happiness in the long run, while deontology more often tells you that you shouldn't do something, for it would violate another person's rights. Now, we all want to be the acting hero in our own story. We want to be vigilantes and save people from thieves and win prizes for finding a cure for cancer. But are these things really all that glorious? What about the circumstances of the purse snatcher or the lab animals being used for cancer research? Personally, I believe it to be much more admirable to constrain the malevolence within. Even if you can't bring the greatest amount of happiness to the greatest number of people, you can at the very least make sure that you yourself don't make things worse and reduce the suffering of the world that way. Now, that may not be optimally utilitarian, but deontology is more about giving a rule for the bare minimum you should do or shouldn't do to be a good and decent human being. Once you meet the deontological requirement, you can still think as a quasi-utilitarian beyond that. You just have limited means at your disposal, since deontology would stand above utilitarianism in your decision-making tree. In contrast to utilitarianism, which tells you that there is only one good choice, deontology still leaves room for virtuous action once the minimal requirement of its supreme rule has been met. It still leaves room for kindness and respect in a way that utilitarianism does not. After all, according to utilitarianism, if it does not serve the end of creating the greatest amount of happiness, it simply can't be the right choice, even if it is kind or respectful. In the same way, utilitarianism does not necessarily condemn acts of murder or torture, for if the circumstances are such that it would serve the total positive happiness over suffering balance of the world, the means by which that is achieved do not matter. I believe this to be wrong. There are, of course, also counter-arguments to deontology. One of my favorite goes as follows. If usings are bad, then are not more usings worse than fewer? And if so, then is it not odd to condemn acts that produce better states of affairs than would occur in their absence? It relates to the dilemma we discussed previously. 1,000 people being killed by someone else, and thus being used, are a lot more usings than the one needed to prevent that. To preemptively kill that killer. The answer to this is that usings cannot be added. The way I concretely look at it is as follows. Every life has infinite moral worth. Whether 1 or 1,000 sentient beings lose their lives, an infinity of worth is lost in both cases. In the same way, if I would have to put a number on the amount of wrong that is done when the deontological rules disregard it, that number would be infinite as well, making every transgression of the rule infinitely and therefore absolutely and always wrong. And to myself from middle school, no, infinity plus one does not exist, that is still infinity. The counter-counter-argument to this is that if people's worths can't be added, then that means there's also no reason to save 5 people instead of saving 1, even if there is no active killing involved. If the numbers don't matter, then the numbers seemingly don't count in either way, is how the argument goes. My reply to that is, of course, what I said before. Once you meet the deontological requirement that you are not using anyone as a mere means, you can still act quasi-utilitarianly. The important thing is that you don't put utilitarianism and deontology on the same footing, is all. You can still take happiness and suffering into account in your decision-making, but first you must have discarded all possible means which use others as a mere means. With the means you have left, you can still attempt to increase happiness, and thus think in a utilitarian-like way. It just won't be increased maximally. Although one has to wonder whether increasing happiness maximally is even feasible. This is seriously doubtful for 2 reasons. One is that pain and pleasure are impossible to measure, and thus impossible to compare between people, because they are both too subjective. Another is that for each decision, there are so many possibilities that it is impossible for us humans, who are not omniscient, to know of all existing possibilities, let alone know which one increases happiness maximally. I can imagine you're tired of my voice right now. I realize this has been quite a long and dry monologue from me, and although I think I have explained my reasoning well enough, I worry that even if you accept these arguments as being logical, meaning that you won't have anything against them, they might not have properly convinced you to actually want to change your mind. And so, just before I make my final argument, let me show you some arguments that speak for deontology and against utilitarianism from other people than just me, from a whole range of mediums.
The Nuremberg judgment, for better or worse, was that there were some acts that were so viciously brutal that there was no excuse whatsoever for engaging in them, no matter who you were, or what your culture was, or what your rationale was.
You ever doubt yourself, Frank?
Not even for a second.
Really? Really? You never think for one second, shit, I just killed a human being.
It's being pretty generous.
A human being who did a lot of stupid shit, maybe even evil, but had one small piece of goodness in him. Maybe just a scrap, Frank, but something. And then you come along and that one tiny flicker of light gets snuffed out forever.
We call it decommissioned.
You stopped his heart. He had a heart. Aorta valve's a real human heart. And you stopped it.
Kate Lethbridge Stewart.
What in the name of sanity are you doing?
The countdown can only be halted at my personal command. There's nothing you can do.
Except, mate, you both agree to halt it.
Not even for three of you.
You're about to murder millions of people.
To save billions. How many times have you made that calculation?
Once. Turn me into the man I am now. I'm not even sure who that is anymore.
You tell yourself it's justified, but it's a lie. Because what I did that day was wrong. Just wrong.
You are never 100%. That the thing you're trying to accomplish is actually going to have a positive effect on the world. There are lots of examples of people having big revolutions against really oppressive things and then it getting even worse afterwards.
So let me ask you a question about this brave new world of yours. When you've killed all the bad guys, and when it's all perfect and just and fair, when you have finally got it exactly the way you want it, what are you going to do with the people like you? The troublemakers. How are you going to protect your glorious revolution from the next one?
We'll win.
Oh, will you? Well, maybe. Maybe you will win. But nobody wins for long. The wheel just keeps turning. So come on. Break the cycle.
Why are you still talking?
Because I want to get you to see, and I'm almost there. This is a scale model of war. Every war ever fought right there in front of you. Because it's always the same. When you fire that first shot, no matter how right you feel, you have no idea who's going to die. You don't know whose children are going to scream and burn.
You never really know. So if you're headed along to this eventual goal and you're just destroying everything on the way there, if this turns out to not have the intended effect, then you've done a lot of bad stuff to get to a bad outcome. Third, you gotta remember that there's a really high chance that you're not gonna get to the desired outcome. You're never gonna get there. So you could do a whole bunch of bad stuff on the way to trying to get there and then fail. And that happens all the time.
How many hearts will be broken? How many lives shattered? How much blood will spill until everybody does what they were always going to have to do from the very beginning? Sit down and talk!
And lastly, I have come to realize that this thing doesn't exist. There is no final end goal. Every single decision along the path of your life is an end in itself. And if the entire world lived as if the ends justify the means, then the means in themselves are gonna be a terrifying end.
If the entire world lived as if the ends justified the means, then the means in themselves are going to be a terrifying end. This has to be the most beautifully succinct way of formulating the argument against utilitarianism. The last few clips also closely relate to a quote from Karl Popper. Philosophers should consider the fact that the greatest happiness principle can easily be made an excuse for a benevolent dictatorship. If and when you fail to reach the end you justified so many means for, you will be crushed. Because it was all for nothing. All the evil you caused, all the wrongs you committed, will never be turned into rights. In contrast, Deontology values every single step along the way and takes care to make sure that each individual step you take is the right one. Now, that of course means that the steps are a lot smaller than the leaps a utilitarian makes, and reaching a happy end will be a lot harder if you can't use the same methods as the evil you fight against. But falling and failing and never reaching the happily ever after is not so bad if at the end you can look back on the road you have walked, that beautifully constructed road of right and just actions, and be proud, even if the road never reaches the destination it was paved toward. The destination is an ideal, a utopia that can never be achieved because there will always be people who continue to use others as a mere means to an end, whom you yourself cannot stop with the limited means at your disposal. But at the same time, it's an ideal that you in a way do attain with every action and which is present in every person. Because the person is the end. Every person is an end in themselves. And this brings us to our fourth and final premise. The deontological categorical imperative is the best supreme rule available. These four premises together form a so-called deductive argument, meaning that if the premises are true, then the conclusion must be true. And the conclusion is that you should never treat another sentient being as a mere means to an end, but always at the same time as an end. Now, because the video is already quite long, I did not extensively go into some things that were a bit beside the point of reaching this conclusion. I can therefore imagine that you still have some questions, for example regarding deontology. I have not discussed all counter-arguments to the theory here, nor have I discussed the different variations of the categorical imperative and why I prefer the second formulation. Maybe some clarification is also warranted into the matter of why not just people, but all sentient beings require equal moral consideration when following the deontological rule. For this last one, I also recommend looking up Tom Reagan, since he's the one who correctly made the adjustments to the rule that not just humans, but also many animals require the same moral consideration. If you are interested in these topics, maybe I could make a follow-up video answering these and other questions you might have. But in any case, for now, thank you so much for watching this very long video. I hope you will decide to follow the deontological rule starting from now.